Fairy Tale, written by Hans Christian Andersen, narrated by Judy Kriz.
The Fir Tree. Far away in the forest, where the warm sun and the fresh air made a sweet resting place, grew a pretty little fir tree. The situation was all that could be desired, and yet the tree was not happy. It wished so much to be like all its tall companions, the pines and firs which grew around it. The sun shone, and the soft air fluttered its leaves, and the little peasant children passed by, prattling merrily, but the fir tree did not heed them. Sometimes, the children would bring a large basket of raspberries or strawberries, wreathed in straws, and seat themselves near the fir tree and say, "Is it not a pretty little tree?" which made it feel even more unhappy than before. And yet, all this while the tree grew a notch or joint taller every year. For by the number of joints in the stem of a fir tree, we can discover its age. Still, as it grew, it complained, "Oh, how I wish I were as tall as the other trees! Then I would spread out my branches on every side, and my crown would overlook the wide world around. I should have the birds building their nests on my boughs, and when the wind blew, I should bow with stately dignity like my tall companions." So discontented was the tree that it took no pleasure in the warm sunshine, the birds, or the rosy clouds that floated over it morning and evening. Sometimes in winter, when the snow lay white and glittering on the ground, there was a little hare that would come springing along and jump right over the little tree's head. Then how mortified it would feel. 2 winters passed, and when the third arrived, the tree had grown so tall that the hare was obliged to run around it. Yet it remained unsatisfied and would exclaim, "Oh, to grow, to grow! If I could but keep on growing tall and old! There is nothing else worth caring for in the world." In the autumn, the woodcutters came, as usual, and cut down several of the tallest trees. And the young fir, which was now grown to a good full height, shuddered as the noble trees fell to the earth with a crash. After the branches were lopped off, the trunks looked so slender and bare that they could scarcely be recognized. Then they were placed, one upon another, upon wagons and drawn by horses out of the forest. Where could they be going? What would become of them? The young fir tree wished very much to know. So in the spring, when the swallows and the storks came and asked, "Do you know where those trees were taken? Did you meet them?" The swallows knew nothing, but the stork, after a little reflection, nodded his head and said, "Yes, I think I do. As I flew from Egypt, I met several new ships, and they had a fine mast that smelt like fir. These must have been the trees, and I assure you they were stately. They sailed right gloriously."
"Oh, how I wish I were tall enough to go on the sea," said the fir tree. "Tell me, what is the sea, and what does it look like?"
"It would take too much time to explain, a great deal too much," said the stork, flying quickly away.
"Rejoice in the youth," said the sunbeam. "Rejoice in thy fresh growth and in the young life that is in thee."
And the wind kissed the tree, and the dew watered it with tears, but the fir regarded them not. Christmas time drew near, and many young trees were cut down, some that were even smaller and younger than the fir tree, who enjoyed neither rest nor peace for longing to leave its forest home. These young trees, which were chosen for their beauty, kept their branches, and they also were laid on wagons and drawn by horses far away out of the forest.
"Where are they going?" asked the fir tree. "They are not taller than I am. Indeed, one is not so tall. And why do they keep all their branches? Where are they going?"
We know," sang the sparrows. "We have looked in at the windows of the houses in the town, and we know what is done with them."
"Oh, You cannot think what honor and glory they receive. They are dressed up in the most splendid manner. We have seen them standing in the middle of a warm room and adorned with all sorts of beautiful things. Honey cakes, gilded apples, playthings, and many hundreds of wax tapers. And then, asked the fir tree, trembling in all his branches. And then what happens? We did not see any more, said the sparrows, but this was enough for us. I wonder whether anything so brilliant will ever happen to me, thought the fir tree. It would be better than crossing the sea. I long for it almost with pain. Oh, when will Christmas be here? I am now as tall and well-grown as those which were taken away last year. Oh, that I were now laid on the wagon, or standing in the warm room with all the brightness and splendor around me. Something better and more beautiful is to come after, or the trees would not be so decked out. Yes, what follows will be grander and more splendid. What can it be? I am weary with longing. I scarcely know what it is that I feel. Rejoice in our love, said the air in the sunshine. Enjoy thine own bright life in the fresh air. But the tree would not rejoice, though it grew taller every day. And winter and summer its dark green foliage might be seen in the forest, while passers-by would say, what a beautiful tree! A short time before the next Christmas, the discontented fir tree was the first to fall. As the axe cut sharply through the stem and divided the pith, the tree fell with a groan to the earth. Conscious of pain and faintness, and forgetting all its dreams of happiness in sorrow at leaving its home in the forest, it knew that it should never again see its dear old companions, the trees, nor the little bushes and many colored flowers that had grown by its side. Perhaps not even the birds. Nor was the journey at all pleasant. The tree first recovered itself while being unpacked in the courtyard of a house with several other trees, and it heard a man say, we only want one, and this is the prettiest. This is beautiful. Then came two servants in grand livery and carried the fir tree into a large and beautiful apartment. Pictures hung on the walls, and near the tall tile stove stood great china vases with lions on the lids. There were rocking chairs, silken sofas, and large tables covered with pictures. And there were books and playthings that had cost 100 times $100. At least so said the children. Then the fir was placed in a large tub full of sand. But green baize hung all around it so that no one could know it was a tub, and it stood on a very handsome carpet. Oh, how the fir tree trembled! What was going to happen to him now? Some young ladies came, and the servants helped them to adorn the tree. On one branch, they hung little bags cut out of colored paper, and each bag was filled with sweetmeats. From other branches hung gilded apples and walnuts, as if they had grown there. And above and all around were hundreds of red, blue, and white tapers, which were fastened upon the branches. Dolls exactly like real men and women were placed under the green leaves. The tree had never seen such things before, and at the very top was fastened a glittering star made of gold tinsel. Oh, it was very beautiful. This evening, they all exclaimed, how bright it will be. Oh, that the evening were come, thought the tree, and the tapers lighted. Then I shall know what is going to happen. Will the trees of the forest come to see me? Will the sparrows peep in at the windows, I wonder, as they fly? Shall I grow faster here than in the forest? And shall I keep on all these ornaments during the summer and winter? But guessing was of very little use. His back ached with trying, and his pain is as bad for a slender fir tree as headache is for us. At last, the tapers were lighted, and then what a glistening blaze of splendor the tree presented.
It trembles so with joy in all its branches that one of the candles fell among the green leaves and burned some of them.
"Help! Help!" exclaimed the young ladies. But no harm was done, for they quickly extinguished the fire.
After this, the tree tried not to tremble at all. Though the fire frightened him, he was so anxious not to hurt any of the beautiful ornaments, even while their brilliancy dazzled him. And now the folding doors were thrown open, and a troop of children rushed in as if they intended to upset the tree, and were followed more slowly by their elders. For a moment, the little ones stood silent with astonishment, and then they shouted for joy till the room rang. And they danced merrily around the tree while one present after another was taken from it.
"What are they doing? What will happen next?" thought the tree.
At last, the candles burned down to the branches and were put out. Then the children received permission to plunder the tree. Oh, how they rushed it! There was such a riot that the branches cracked, and had it not been fastened with the glistening star to the ceiling, it must have been thrown down. Then the children danced about with their pretty toys, and no one noticed the tree except the children's maid, who came and peeped among the branches to see if an apple or a fig had been forgotten.
"A story! A story!"
cried the children, pulling a little fat man towards the tree. "Now we shall be in the green shade," said the man as he seated himself under it, "and the tree will have the pleasure of hearing also. But I shall only relate one story. What shall it be? Avida Avida? Or Humpty Dumpty, who fell downstairs, was soon got up again, and at least married a princess?"
"Avida, Avida," cried some.
"Humpty Dumpty," cried others. And there was a famous uproar. But the fir tree remained quite still and thought to himself, "Shall I have anything to do with all this? Ought I make a noise too?" But he had already amused them as much as they wished, and they paid no attention to him. Then the old man told them the story of Humpty Dumpty and how he fell downstairs and was raised up again and married a princess. But the children clapped their hands and cried, "Tell another, tell another," for they wanted to hear the story of Avida Avida. But this time they had only Humpty Dumpty. After this, the fir tree became quite silent and thoughtful. Never had the birds in the forest told such tales as that of Humpty Dumpty, who fell downstairs and yet married a princess.
"Ah, yes! So it happens in the world," thought the fir tree. He believed it all because it was related by such a pleasant man. "I will," he thought. "Who knows? Perhaps I may fall down, too, and marry a princess."
And he looked forward joyfully to the next evening, expecting to be again decked out with the lights and playthings, gold and fruit.
"Tomorrow I will not tremble," thought he. "I will enjoy all the splendor, and I shall hear the story of Humpty Dumpty again, and perhaps of Avida Avida."
And the tree remained quiet and thoughtful all night. In the morning, the servants and the housemaid came in.
"Now," thought the fir tree, "all my splendor is going to begin again."
But they dragged him out of the room and upstairs to the garret and threw him on the floor in a dark corner where no daylight shone. And there they left him.
"What does this mean?" thought the tree. "What am I to do here? I can hear nothing in a place like this."
And he leaned against the wall and thought and thought. And he had time enough to think, for days and nights passed, and no one came near him. And when at last somebody did.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.